Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture in hopefully the most Renaissance-man-like manner in which arts and culture can be discussed. So stay tuned for that. Now, I just did one video about Lionel Messi and the idea that his bad World Cup performances might affect his legacy, which in Argentina, they certainly are affecting his legacy, and all over the world, in every other country, not so much. So I think in Argentina, people will keep ranking Diego Maradona as the greatest Argentinian player of all time, and in every other country, people will rank Lionel Messi as the greatest Argentinian of all time. So in one country, the World Cup performances absolutely matter. In all other countries, they are treated as negligible. So I just tried, in the last video that I tried to make a case as to why it's unfair to hold Messi directly responsible for every single problem that the Argentinian national team has. So I think that there's actually a perfect storm on two different levels why Messi hasn't been able to come through with the Argentinian team. So on one hand, I think that there's certain strategic deficiencies with the way that the Argentinian team is playing football in the Messi era, where I don't think that they are having the right head coaches that are able to get the most out of the performance, the most optimal kind of performance out of the players. And then the other problem is that the other teams are quite simply better. So if I would rank the greatest national teams in my lifetime that didn't win the World Cup, I don't think I would rank a single Argentinian team on that list. Or if I did, the highest ranked Argentinian team that I might put is the Diego Simeone, Javier Zanetti, Gabriel Batistuta, 98 Argentinian team that ran into a really hot team from the Netherlands, and they had better luck as far as the knockout stages was concerned. They might have been able to get a bit further. Incidentally, I think that the 98 Dutch team probably would be what I consider the best team in my lifetime to not win the World Cup. And obviously, the Netherlands has an even more sad World Cup history than Messi's Argentina does. So you either know or don't know, but they also have certain heartbreaking losses there for them. And, I don't think the Dennis Bergkamp era is necessarily the greatest era for Dutch football, in that whether you want to talk of Johan Cruyff or Marco van Basten or whatever you want to talk, like the Dutch have had brilliant talent in so many generations. But, the 98 team, the only problem that the Dutch team had is that they weren't the only great team in 98. So, the Brazilians, I don't know, like, to me the Netherlands-Brazil was kind of a coin flip game anyway. They both had great teams, and then maybe if the Netherlands would have been able to win, they would have just gone to lose to France in the finals. So the only thing wrong with the Netherlands in that tournament would have been that they weren't the best team. Maybe France was. So anyway, if we'd rank the greatest national team from 1990 to 2018 never to win the World Cup, I don't think too many of the Messi Argentinian sides would be ranked. I mean, some people would put the 2014 Argentinian team that went to the finals, but really, from 1990 to 2018, I mean, I don't think that Argentinian team would have been some sort of a heavy favorite in any tournament. And I think it's sort of an indictment of the 2014 World Cup if that Argentinian team would have been seen as the one of the heavyweights in that tournament. It seemed like all of the other heavyweights just found ways to lose, like Italy and France and all the rest. But yeah, that's his own story, and I made that other video about it. But I thought that I'd make this video just about the conversation around the greatest of all time, because it seems like, I'll be honest, to me it seems like it's the American influence on sports discussion. I don't ever hear that being mentioned in Finland, so people don't really have any kind of passionate debates about who the greatest Finnish hockey player of all time is. If we keep this strictly football related, I guess Jari Litmanen would be unquestionably the best football player that Finland ever produced, and maybe Sami Hyypiä or Aulis Rytkönen would compete who the number two, number three is. But anyway, because in football, it's so obvious that it's Jari Litmanen that nobody bothers to have the conversation. And then in hockey, it's not really that obvious, but I would just put down, Jari Kurri, Teemu Selänne might sort of be in the conversation about the hockey players. But anyway, I would just say that in Finland, no one can be bothered to have any kind of greatest of all time discussions. I don't think that idea of needing to crown somebody the king of a given sport. I think that's an American thing. I don't think that people in China or people in South Africa or people in New Zealand or people in Denmark, I don't think that they really feel the need to have that greatest of all time discussion the way that it seems like people specifically from the United States it seems like that greatest of all time discussion has some sort of a magnetic attraction to them. So basically the first time that I ever started hearing of the word GOAT mentioned alongside sports was with Jerry Rice, the wide receiver legend for San Francisco 49ers. And basically, I initially thought that the GOAT nickname was sort of Jerry Rice specific, but then people started mentioning it in relation with Michael Jordan, and then some people wanted to make it some sort of Michael Jordan versus LeBron James discussion in basketball. Then people started mentioning GOAT in relation with Tom Brady. Now it seems like, I don't know whether there's some sort of an Americanization of the younger generation on the global landscape, but it seems like, because Americans are having the GOAT conversations about NBA or NFL related situation, it seems like they are inspiring others to have that type of GOAT discussions when it comes to this kind of global football scene. I guess I personally find it alternatively silly and alternatively tedious. So, some of you may or may not remember that George Clooney and Ewan McGregor once starred in a movie called The Men Who Stare at GOATs. Now, if some of you don't really have any opinions when that old new movie is mentioned, whatever emotions you are feeling when somebody talks about The Men Who Stare at GOATs, you can probably guess what type of emotions I'm feeling when some people turn the football discussion about who the greatest of all time is. So basically, the short answer is, I don't understand why Americans want to turn themselves into a country of men who stare at GOATs, and why some foreign viewers want to become so Americanized that they also become men who stare at girls. But it just seems to be sort of there in the culture, so I'm talking about it as a result. But anyway, my own personal opinion is the same that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar had when he was asked who the greatest of all time is. And Kareem said that we can't ever know. So basically the short answer is that if you take two all-time great players who are from different eras, so Bill Russell and Steph Curry, who haters are gonna hate, but we can already say that Steph Curry is going down as an all-time great player, so that's not a debate. But anyway, so if you put Bill Russell and Steph Curry against one another and say, who is better, well, it seems like Kareem is saying that that's an absurd competition, because Bill Russell and Steph Curry were each other's opposites in so many ways. In Steph Curry's NBA, they are having more teams than ever before. They are having more money in the culture than ever before. And there's maybe a greater level of talent in a generation than ever before. Whereas when Bill Russell was in NBA, they had fewer teams than ever before, less money, maybe less talent in a generation as far as top to bottom or some sort of median talent is concerned. And, you know, just Steph Curry, Bill Russell, they did different things on the court. So I don't see how you can say that Bill Russell is better than Steph Curry, that Steph Curry is better than Bill Russell, because they are making themselves relevant in different ways. So I think that's why the greatest of all time discussion is ultimately rendered both tedious and annoying and silly. It's because there's no objective level of evaluating Bill Russell against Steph Curry. Who is better? They're both really great. I can't tell you who is better. And if Kareem Abdul-Jabbar can tell you who's better, I think that that should seal the deal that there's no objective discussion about who is better. They're both good at doing different things. So, I personally don't want to have that greatest of all time discussion. Just like, I don't want to beat Jari Kurri against Teemu Selänne. They're both great at slightly different things. They both had a good impact in the National Hockey League in North America. I don't wanna put myself at a team. Well, since I mentioned Steph Curry and Jari Kurri, maybe I should pronounce them the same. Just for comedy's sake, but no relation, Jari Kurri and Steph Curry, no relation, but anyway, so I just want to side with that Kareem Abdul-Jabbar situation, in that I don't want to have the greatest of all time discussion, in that in some situations, like Babe Ruth in baseball, or Wayne Gretzky in hockey, the greatest of all time is so obvious that people don't need to have the conversation. But if in some situations, like in football, it's not so obvious. So I feel like that's why when people are insisting as if it is that obvious, that's when it becomes tedious. So that's why I don't particularly want to contribute to the situation. Anyway, so I guess what I would want to say about the greatest of all time discussion about football is that if in basketball, when people are wanting to make it either a Michael Jordan versus LeBron James situation, I think that the three players that most deserve to be added to that mix are Bill Russell, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and Shaquille O'Neal. So if Bill Russell has the most championships in NBA history, if Kareem has the most points in NBA history, if Michael Jordan has the most points per game in NBA history, and then Shaquille O'Neal was widely considered to be the most unstoppable player in his era, like I think that Shaq would be kind of an ultimate dark horse in the greatest ever discussion. I don't think many people would side with Shaq, but I think that he deserves to be at least halfway in the conversation, slightly more than the people who just want to purely make it a Michael Jordan versus LeBron James situation. And that I think certainly Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Bill Russell have a far better case than anyone seems to want to admit. And basically, I think ultimately the reason why there's something so unfair about comparing different players from different eras is that if the player comparison for Bill Russell in modern NBA would be Tim Duncan. You know, Duncan was able to be perfectly relevant in his era, and we are seeing how San Antonio Spurs cannot be the same dynasty post-Duncan that they were with Tim Duncan, and that Spurs were consistently brilliant whenever they had Tim Duncan, and they are just somehow less so without Duncan. I certainly think that Bill Russell could have that kind of a comparable impact in today's NBA. And, you know, Tim Duncan, I don't want to say that he wasn't a versatile player, but it's not as if he was some sort of a unicorn in the modern sports idiom. So that's what I'm mainly basing it on. But, you know, just the idea that, because modern players, there's the assumption that there's a more, there's a demand imposed on modern players to be more versatile than what players used to be. I think what's unfair is that people are assuming as if the older generation players couldn't acclimatize themselves to those versatile demands that what modern players are acclimatizing to themselves to. I mean, it's not as if James Harden was born already being the player that he is right now, or Anthony Davis was born already being the player that he was right now. What Harden and Davis may have had is enormous amount of raw talent that they just started chiseling that talent to the final form that is right now. But anyway, just like a block of marble may be sculpted to take a given shape. You know, if those earlier era players like Julius Erving or Bill Russell, if they had a massive amount of raw talent, they could acclimatize to a more modern way of doing things. And basically, because they didn't play the modern way in the past, some people are acting like they couldn't play the modern way in the past. But like when Will Chamberlain was criticized for you know, the kind of all he does is score mentality, he made a point of leading the league in assists next year as a center, and I think he did do it. So again, those players could acclimatize to more than what they ended up acclimatizing themselves to. And, you know, frequently when some players like Pete Maravich, when they were ahead of their time, they were frequently criticized. Like, people started dissing Pistol Pete of just being a shallow show-off. And when he would have had a slightly more modern way of approaching the game, you know, people just thought that he should retire and join the Harlem Globetrotters or something. I don't know whether he would have been too pale for them. he certainly wasn't playing like any of the General Washingtons. That's just what I'm trying to say. But anyway, like, it's not only that players from the old times, they weren't asked to play the modern way, but sometimes when they did play the modern way, they were heavily criticized and people tried to pressure themselves to acclimatize to the old-fashioned way. So the kind of conversation thinking that the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar or Julius Ervings of the world, like, they couldn't do what the modern players are doing, that's the unfair level. Like, you don't know what those players could do or couldn't do. So, you know, that's why the bias favoring the modern players by modern viewers, it's kind of, you know, well, I guess the nicest way I can say it is that it's kind of sad to see that happening. And then if I bring this conversation to football, I just think that there's a comparable situation in that there's two sets of biases, I think. So, well, maybe three sets of biases, in that the obvious bias is that people have sympathies to some players and antipathies to some players. So if you're a Cristiano Ronaldo fan, you underrate Messi, and if you're a Messi fan, you underrate Cristiano Ronaldo. And it doesn't seem like there are people who are fair and balanced and can appreciate greatness from both of those players. So there's those personal related biases, but then I think that the other two main biases that I see in this kind of GOAT conversation with football is that there's a massive bias favoring modern players by modern fans, but there's also a massive bias favoring forwards against every other player. So basically, just like I think that it would be absurd to compare Steph Curry to Bill Russell and have a debate about who's better, because they both found different ways of being relevant. I also think that it's absurd saying that Lionel Messi has been more integral to the teams that he's played than what Franz Beckenbauer or Paolo Maldini were to the teams that they played. Because I don't see how Beckenbauer could have been more of a difference maker than he was. Like, there's a clear bias against the position that Beckenbauer played, and people don't even want to admit him to the conversation simply because he wasn't a forward. So, I mean, or Paolo Maldini. Like, I don't see how Paolo Maldini could have been more of a difference maker for AC Milan or for the Italian men's national team. Like, Maldini was as integral to the success of the teams that he played as Messi or Ronaldo, Zidane, or any of those forward-type players. So, again, there's a clear bias that's underrating everything that more defensive-minded players are doing. And, again, like, look at the impact that somebody like Franz Beckenbauer had for the German sides that he was playing in. Like, I mean, I don't see how anyone can take that for granted. I mean, that is all-time greatness that should at the very least be admitted to the conversation. So again, I think that there's a massive bias favoring the modern players against the older players, and some people are calling that being a prisoner of the moment. And it is what it is. And one generation can keep lionizing their guys, but then fast forward 20 years, and then the Ronaldos and Messis of this era will become the Michel Platinis and Diego Maradonas of the next era. And the young people of 20 years from now, they just underrate the old players, and they say that, oh, those guys weren't that great. They can't mess with any of our young stars and whatever. So, this situation, it's like a double-edged sword, in that if this present generation will underrate everything that's happened in the past, they just keep maintaining the culture that this present era will be the past at some point, and then whatever greatness is happening here will be underrated. So just like people are already forgetting of all of the greatness that Raul had for Real Madrid. I mean, he was an absolute legend. Same thing that Iker Casillas was an absolute legend for Real Madrid. But people are already transitioning away from that, acting like they weren't even there. Like, when Iker Casillas was at Real Madrid, it would have been unthinkable, having the kind of mentality that, we can replace all of this Casillas or Raul type players. It would have been unthinkable then, but then time goes on, and then people act like those club legends weren't even there sometimes. I mean, maybe that's more of a casual fan thing, but still, just like people could easily move away from Iker Casillas and Raul, I think that there might be a situation that people are just moving away from even the biggest stars of the biggest clubs. It's because of the bias for whatever's happening right now or whatever has happened in the last 3 years and so on. So again, this is just something that everyone has to be on the receiving end of trivialization of the past, if that is the kind of culture that is there. So, you know, like, if people want to maintain that, then that's it is what it is. But I would just point out that it seems like that is happening. Like, in baseball, no one in their right mind would say that Mike Trout is better than Babe Ruth. But, in the other sports, it seems like whoever is the Mike Trout of some given sport, they don't mind comparing them favorably to the Babe Ruths of the world or whatever. Anyway, I think that there's a flip side to that situation, which is like some people clearly do have some sort of almost like a historicist bias. I saw some comment on YouTube where Cristiano Ronaldo was called an all-time great player and mentioned as one of the biggest legends ever to appear in the World Cup. And some YouTube commentator said that it's ridiculous seeing Cristiano Ronaldo mentioned in the same sentence as Maradona. But I don't understand why. I mean, a player like Cristiano Ronaldo would be able to be a difference maker in any era. Like, if you fast forward to early 60s and you replace somebody like Ferenc Puskas or Di Stefano in the El Clásicos of the early 60s with a Cristiano Ronaldo, do you seriously think that Cristiano in the 60s couldn't, become a difference maker the way that Di Stefano was able to become? In that, it's absolutely absurd people acting like, if you put Cristiano Ronaldo to the Michel Platini era, like, he couldn't be a difference maker. Like, he couldn't do what Gary Lineker did. I mean, come on. Just wake up, honestly. Like, Ronaldo is an all-time great player, and he absolutely does deserve to be mentioned in the same sentence as whatever those other massive legends of the World Cup are. So, even though the Portuguese side, they've probably only been able to have two World Cup performances that they like. The Eusebio performance in the English World Cup at, 1966? And then the 2006 World Cup that the Luis Figo and Cristiano Ronaldo were able to have a top four finish. But anyway, I understand to what an extent the Portuguese side has underperformed, but you shouldn't really hold Ronaldo. I mean, like, you shouldn't really hold that against Cristiano Ronaldo, because a lot of the top all-time talent, just hasn't been able to get to the World Cup level. So, I think that some people have the modern bias, some people have some sort of historicist bias, where they're thinking that Pele or Ferenc Puskas or Maradona type old stars, like, they were some sort of a kung fu masters out of Chinese wuxia movies, where they were able to fly over the field and they were able to have some sort of backflip goals where it's like something out of an anime or something, where no one can stop those legendary masters of football, and everything would have been better in the past and whatever. But the fact is that the game evolves and the younger players are, it's the Isaac Newton thing. When Isaac Newton was starting to get lionized in the 18th century, he famously said that he's standing on the shoulders of giants and that he shouldn't be praised alone. You know, that's what's happening with these cultures, that the younger athletes, the game has evolved. Maybe the athletes have a greater median talent than the past generations, but everyone is standing at the shoulders of giants. Like, Lionel Messi couldn't be the player he is without Johan Cruyff. That's just the harsh reality of the situation, in that Johan Cruyff needed to have such a high impact on the world of football, to the Barcelona football, that popularizing the Dutch mentality of the total football. And a lot of the best samples of the modern game that we are all appreciating, it couldn't have happened without Johan Cruyff. And so, you know, if you say that Messi is better than Johan Cruyff, you can say that, but you couldn't get Messi without Johan Cruyff. So Johan Cruyff is that shoulders of giants that Messi is now standing on. So, like, you know, you need to be able to take both. Take the past for what it is, take the modern game for what it is, not beat Johan Cruyff against Lionel Messi. So there's no one winning when it becomes some sort of a situation that you're waving the pom-poms for one particular player and then spitting on the legacy of every other player because you want to, favor just one type player. So, you know, that's just making the culture kind of ugly, ultimately. And, you know, I want to appreciate all of those different parties who were doing something, something for the football. So, you know, I'm obviously not old enough to have really been watching Pele when he was at his peak. My father, for whatever it's worth, he watched both Pele and watched Messi, and he rates Messi more highly than Pele. But I realized that there's also some viewpoints for a lot of that. But anyway, just the point that I'm trying to make in all of these videos is that I don't even want to have that greatest of all time discussion. So if in some cases somebody like Babe Ruth or Wayne Gretzky, they have the stats that are better than anyone else, then they can be crowned as the best of all time. But if there is something ambiguous about the stats and that there's more of a, you know, that it's just a matter of taste or a matter of who you're a fan of, I don't want to push the culture into that direction. I just think that it's somehow a reductionist position, and, you know, there's some sort of a maintaining of scarcity. I mean, you know, in 2006, I think Zinedine Zidane was still the greatest player in the world at that time. But, you know, in that early 2000 period, like, I never heard any conversation about comparing Dennis Bergkamp to Zinedine Zidane, or, comparing Luis Figo to Zinedine Zidane, or Francesco Totti to any of those players or whatever. So, like, in that era that I grew up with, it just seemed like there was a greater parity for the European leagues, the pre-super team era, where, if in mid-90s, the teams like Borussia Dortmund, Marseille, Ajax could win Champions League, that you really could have a wide array of winners, and there was a wide array of legends still there, and I don't know, it just seems like there was just something so much grander and so much more beautiful about it, where, respecting somebody like Paolo Maldini, it wasn't respect away from Lothar Matthäus, and, you know, so on. So respect for Peter Schmeichel wasn't respect away from Edwin van der Sar, and so on. I don't know, it just seems to me like the more beautiful way of going about things, and I guess it just seems to be the culture around football that I grew up with, and I don't know, it just seems like this kind of this dumbing down of the conversation that everything needs to be Barcelona versus Real Madrid, or Real Madrid versus the world, or Premier League versus all of the other leagues, or Messi versus every other legend ever. And it's just, honestly, it just seems alternatively silly and sad, and I don't know who the greatest football player of all time is, but I will say that the 2008 to 2012 Messi, I've never seen, like, you know, Zidane in late 90s and early 2000s, and Messi in around 2008 to 2012, and maybe Cristiano Ronaldo in the last 3 years now. I mean, maybe that's as dominant as I've seen a player be in my lifetime. I mean, funnily enough, I mean, Michael Owen would be a massive wild card in that, you know, Michael Owen in Liverpool, he was a crazily special player then and there. But, you know, some injuries, some transfers that maybe didn't work out that well. I mean, it is what it is. You know, there have been lots of great performances from lots of players in my life. Maybe Messi in that 2008-2012 period, maybe Messi would have been just in a league of his own, but anyway, I don't want to push the conversation around that greatest of all time. And I'm not criticizing the Americans. If somebody thinks that NBA is more fun if you have some sort of Michael Jordan versus LeBron James type situation, or contrasting the Golden State dynasty to the Bulls dynasty, if somebody thinks that that makes NBA more fun, you know, good for them. I don't try to be a presence in the culture like that. So I just, you know, Joel Klatt, who's a football or American-style football analyst for Fox Sports, you know, when some people have started to hate Alabama Crimson Tide of being so dominant in the NCAA football level, you know, Joel Klatt asked, or that's when they're criticizing Alabama, do they hate greatness? Why wouldn't you want Alabama Clemson type finals if those are the best games that will eventually become legendary? And, you know, I'll be honest, since we are shifting away from the global football to the just American style football, like, I would rather want to see some teams like Miami or Notre Dame or USC or even Stanford be able to make some Final Four runs. I'm more than happy to watch Alabama Clemson finals if it is something for the ages. And basically that's the attitude that I have with a lot of this situation, in that, you know, I just want something to be memorable and something to be an all-time great event, and I'm not really that invested into thinking that it has to be just one particular player or team being there. So I'm just open to seeing the game played the right way, and I don't want to take any kind of reductionist position that you know, the culture just gets dumped down into seeing one or two players or clubs as that only a couple of parties can be relevant, and everyone else is relegated to the fringes. That's not really how I like seeing the culture. Culture happens, so you know. I don't know. I'm just trying to well, I don't know if I'm trying to do anything, but I guess I just naturally come from some completely different perspective with this situation. And basically, I think that with this greatest of all time discussion with football, I just think that, well, some casual fans clearly don't watch as much football as the biggest football fans in Europe would watch it. So that, you know, like some people, they watch half of the Premier League games that are there. There was the top games from La Liga. They might watch the occasional derbies from Bundesliga or Serie A. They'll watch every Champions League game. They might watch some Europa League game. They'll watch every World Cup game, every European Championship game, maybe even every South American Championship game. They'll watch every qualifying game that their countries are playing or some top countries are playing. And that, you know, the fans who are watching the biggest amount of football, I don't know, like, there's just so much there to appreciate that I just ultimately think that it's the casual fans who then, like, come and try to overcompensate, and they just try to have some sort of shortcut to the top, and that top is the greatest of all time, and that's when people just try to shout that, you know, their favorite player should be in the greatest of all time discussion, and I guess that's just making it silly in that, you know, like, if I do this with a Newcastle jersey, obviously, post Alan Shearer, Newcastle hasn't really been in the in the thick of things, but, you know, just saying that, I can hang in there with players who aren't in the greatest of all time discussion and still get something out of the overall experience. And I hope that there are other people who are also able to have that. So anyway, if you are there, God bless you and good luck, and hope there's some good football played somewhere around you. But anyway, that's all for me. I thank you for watching, and bye bye for now.